Hello, my name is Vincent Reed. I'm going to be delving into the past of a man that lived 1,000 lives before turning 30, a man that I've looked up to since I was only a boy, a man I call Dad. But what I'll be focusing on today is one of the many chapters throughout his life. I'll be interviewing Jason about his experiences whilst being forced to become a Jehovah's Witness when he was a kid. This is his story. So, Jason, tell us a bit about yourself. How old are you? Where did you come from? Maybe what you do for a living, etc.
I'm from a place called Bracknell, Great Orlands in Bracknell to be specific. My name is Jason Reed. I'm 47. Lost a year there. yeah, pretty much that's it. Oh, I'm a roofer. I've got a small roofing business. That's what it was like when you came, when you grew up in my area. You were either academically good or good with your hands. Good with my hands, so roofing was what I went into.
I understand that when you were a bit younger, you became a Jehovah's Witness. What happened with that? How come?
So my mum married a Jamaican guy, and he loved to talk or debate with people. He was a big debater, and as back in them days, they used to knock on your door with the watchtower. Normally they'd get told where to go, but in this instance he decided to invite them in and have a big old chat about it. And then they basically convinced him, or he was convinced, or he convinced himself, that this was the path to take. And we didn't have any option. Being part of his household, that was it. You are doing what he says. So that's what happened.
What did it feel like for you when you had to accept this new reality of being in a religious household?
Well, it felt like I was being pushed into something that I didn't want to do, and was highly embarrassing as a young, I think I was 13, 14. So at that age, you're all about your friends and what you look like. You know, that's how your brain thinks at that time. So it was not a great thing. I was rebelled against it massively, immensely, as much as I could. But we still had to toe the line because it's his house. And, you know, you've got to sort of have a bit of harmony in the house. So, you know, it was not a great thing, and I didn't like it at all.
How dramatically did your life change after becoming a Jehovah's Witness?
It wasn't so much so I had two parts of my life. My life was out with my friends and all that, and that didn't change. No one sort of turned their back on me because I had a good set of friends. They just accepted that, you know, something else was going on in my life, and we used to just laugh about it, you know, take the mick out of it. But at the same time, it did change because I had to go out in the street knocking on people's doors, which was just, I just wanted the floor to swallow me up and eat me. Because not only was we doing that, it wasn't in another area, it was in our own area, so everybody saw you doing it. So I had to like front that, like, yeah, well, have you got something to say? Because you better not say it. So that was, it changed, it sort of made things difficult to be me. But again, you live in the household, you've got a total line.
Did you at any point start to believe in what you were being told to believe?
I didn't believe in it. I've never believed, and it made me disbelieve even more that there is a God. I truly believe that religion is a crutch for people to have in their life to make them, to give them some sort of sense of purpose or keep their life in a straight and narrow. I sincerely do not believe that there's a God. And I can make that decision because we had to have a Bible study. So you'd have to sit there in people's front rooms and they'd talk all about the Bible. So I actually do know about the Bible, so I can make that decision without being ignorant about it. If you just make a decision based on ignorance, oh, there is no, then it's not really a decision that you've, you know, because you've got to be able to back that up.
What are the things that you used to do to rebel against this way of life?
So we would have, I'd have a one-to-one sort of religious book Sunday meeting where they'd have one of their elders come and talk to you and try and... So I was massively into hip-hop. I got a question, as serious as cancer. Who can keep the average dancer hyper as a heart attack? Nobody's smiling, because you're expressing the rhyme that I'm styling. And there was KOS-1. If you don't know me by now, I doubt you'll ever know me. I never won a Grammy, I won't win a Tony. But I'm not the only MC keeping it real. When I grab the mic to smash rap, my girls go ill. I used to listen to him, and he would rap about the first people being black.
The truth, however, is that all Africans did not arrive in Britain, the United States, or the Caribbean as slaves. Africans have been traveling the earth since the beginning of humankind, and Africans were already in the Americas when Europeans arrived.
When man became man, apparently it came through Africa. So therefore, in his mind or his teaching, then everybody stemmed from black people. So this was my sort of ammo that I would go into the meeting with, and I would just reel that off. So how comes Adam and Eve are white then? Prove that to me, because the first people who were human came through hot sun, baking sun through Africa, so they must have been black. So that's the sort of thing I used to just throw at the table just to throw them off or get them talking about something else so I didn't have to listen to it.
What was the lowest point you had to face while being in that environment?
Knocking on the doors, walking around my own neighbourhood, knocking on doors, and all your friends or people you knew, or because there was a few little gang environments around where I was, and then they'd see and just laugh, and that would be the worst thing, getting laughed at and pointed at when you just didn't want to be there. So basically that, really. I suppose you call it peer pressure, but, you know, that was the worst point.
Was there anything positive that you gained from this experience, and or is there anything you still do / still use to this day from the experience that you had?
Positive thing was they were lovely people. They were nice people. See, it wasn't a horrible environment like a cult or anything where you couldn't do... I mean, no birthday, no Christmas, that was horrible. But thankfully, we only had to do it once. But, I mean, that was the positives. Like, you were around nice people, and they were, you know, they were good people. So it wasn't a horrible environment.
Cool.
As far as taking things away from it today, I mean, I think my mum done a good problem, but I think tolerating people... I think it helps me grow as I'm able to adapt to different situations or different people, because I've been in that situation, so I'm not ignorant to religious talkings or anything like that. Like, some people will just go, I can listen, and I'll listen, that's not a problem for me, and I'll take certain things in, but I think that it maybe taught me a bit of humility about people. Oh, mirror in the sky, what is love? Can the child within my heart rise above? Can I sail through the changing ocean tides? Can I handle the seasons of my life?